Hello friends, you are watching the Policy Times and I am Akram Haq. The Policy Times is India's only channel which talks about public policy, advocacy and activism. And I am extremely forward. So we are here in Aligarh today at the Aligarh Muslim University campus. And we are very fortunate enough to have Professor Imran Saleem, who is the professor at Department of Commerce. And previously he has been a gold medalist. And he has worked with World Bank, various projects under World Bank and United Nations. He has also been dean and chairman at Jamia Hamdard University in Delhi, and also he was, I think, dean at the Singhania University. So, sir, welcome to our show.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. It is really a welcome that a TV channel has started this initiative, which is actually required. Be it any government, I think policy interventions and policy backup has to be there. A think tank has to be there, and think tank doesn't mean that sitting a few people sitting in the room and just deliberating. The policies have to be formulated bottom up, and therefore the importance of the common man is more than the one sitting in the policy room, I believe.
Thank you so much for the kind words, sir. I want to start with this point that, we saw a new government, a majority government coming to power and ruled the country for almost five years now. Given the country's potential, given the international development and given the structural changes in the politics of this country, how do you see Indian economy stand today?
Well, in the first place, I would really express this view very explicitly that I strongly believe that a government with a majority is a welcome. That really soothes the policy making, and it is, it doesn't inhibit the power pressures, the political pressures, and it is independent of policy formulation. So, in the first place, I really feel that if the nation is in the hand of majority government, it is better off. That's one thing. But when it comes to formation of the government and the performance of the economy during last 5 years, so it is amply clear that the economy has not been able to perform as it ought to be. I strongly believe that Indian economy has a lot of potential. But we need to understand certain very basic fundamental things. See, in the first place, we are producing roughly 3 crores every year. We are adding it to which are maturing, which become eligible for the work, 21 age.
3 crore so, people, youngsters.
Youngsters. The bonus capital that we often term it. So this 3 crores, maybe on the lower side, if we take 2.5. So roughly out of this, 40% you can take as homemakers, right? Though the composition is changing fast and we are becoming aware on the equity of the gender. Right. But still we can safely say that roughly 35-40%. So if we take 40%, is still taking the total data as an addition of 2.5, we need to generate a minimum of 1.5 crores of employment every year, which I believe is not being done. And see, and to the common man, and lots of media things are upcoming, which says that government should create more employment, more jobs. Jobs are not there. Industry is saying that people are not there who have the skill set required, and jobs are there. Government also endorses that. But I strongly feel that it is not, it is a concern, it is a national concern, and it ought to be a national concern that little jobs are there. But what is my perception, which is a bigger problem that we are not foreseeing and media is not being able to cover, that is falling labor participation. Now, let me explain for a while that what do I mean by labor participation. Labor participation, the common man, I don't think would be able to appreciate that, but the reality is that labor participation means you have the skill set and still you are not looking for a befitting job. Right. Now, this speaks of a psychological thing. See, when we say economy doesn't mean money. Economy means confidence, confidence of the consumer, confidence of the public. So I strongly believe that this falling labor participation is the major cause of concern, because that shows that our youth's confidence in the system is eroding.
Right.
If I don't get a job, maybe I don't have the skill set, maybe I have not tried hard enough to get the job. But when I stop looking for a job, that shows my lack of confidence. That shows that I have accepted the things the way they are coming. That is a panicking situation.
Okay, so it's a two-way thing. One, from the government side, they have to create jobs. From the people's side, they also, apart from the skill set, skill development, they should also go out and seek for jobs. That's what you were trying to say.
No, sir. My perception is that the people's confidence is being shaken.
Okay, so
they have stopped looking for the jobs. They have accepted okay. This that there are no jobs, and we are not going to get jobs.
Okay,
that so is the problem.
What should now they do? Because I do not want to extend this part, but then should they resist the existing model or system? What do you suggest?
See, resistance is not the way out. I strongly believe that we need to see there have to be twofold strategy. I believe in the first place the government will have to work a little more on the skill set aspect of the people. When I say skill set, means not necessarily the mobile repairing and that has been claimed in right. Skill India. We need to provide the skill set which actually the industry is looking at. It is
so the entire skill set campaign that this government has done and invested huge amount of money. There are many now criticism that the money has not been properly utilized, and a huge of money has been siphoned away from the system through the different routes.
Definitely, I strongly believe that it is just the political slogan and siphoning of money, because we don't see, we are such a big institution, a university catering more than 35,000 students. I don't see much of the funding coming from the government, which is basically targeting for the skill set enhancement. See, there is a cut in every research area, almost every walk of life in education. How can you see? You cannot separate education and skill set. Industry doesn't need mechanics. They do need people. They do need engineers who have the education base as well as the skill set required.
Right.
So the point is, the money is not coming to the right channels, and the money is not being optimally utilized. The right. skill set that we are calling for are too little, too petty.
So it means you are raising a very important and a very different aspect, which I have often been hearing, that the government is making budgets and the money is going actually in the country, but they're not going through the channels they're supposed to. But the money is going through different channels. And on paper, the investment is there. So, but I do not want to extend this. I want to come to the second aspect. You have broad employment as one of the priority areas when we talked about the potential of the economy. Now, as journalists, is the manufacturing is the base of creating employment. And different economists has been saying that. How do you... So, this government came up with a slogan that Make in India, and through which it tried to make India a manufacturing hub, the global manufacturing hub. How do you see the Make in India campaign took off?
I would just say, Mr. Akram, one thing. See, for instance, you take any city. Make in India campaign is there. Can I have a specific data that these many units have been created? See, Make in India is a very good approach, is a very good program, but it has not been backed up. It has not been well received by the industry. Reason being very simple, because people, there is a disconnect between the government and the industry. I believe it is, the majority of our manufacturing sector comes from unorganized sector, which have been dampened by the demonetization done by this government. And I strongly feel, when you establish an FDI comes, highly automated factory you create and you say 500 jobs have been created. Well, very good. But have you calculated as a backlash of that industry establishment, how many ancillary and small units have been closed because of that and thousands of people get unemployed? I strongly feel that if the manufacturing is to be evolved and developed, it has to come from within. We have to instill the confidence. What I am trying to raise here is that it is the lack of the confidence of the public which is a cause of concern for the nation, for any government, be it BJP, be it Congress or anybody. I mean, the election is just round the corner. We are going to elect a new government. Whichsoever government comes, I think the first priority should be to address in building up the confidence of the public. Unless the confidence, because when it comes to FDI, see, number one, that comes with a huge lot of technology. These are the large scale industries, big industries, which are automated. So not many of the jobs are created. And on the contrary, I'll say jobs are dislodged because of closing of the smaller units working into that area. Okay. So the manufacturing sector has to be evolved from within. We have to put in
schemes. That's a very nice idea. Yeah. We have done it wrong, I think.
Yes, of course. Actually, if you calculate, I'm pretty sure I have not calculated. If I get an opportunity to work on this, I'll just work out that the outflow because of the FDI must be much higher when compared to inflows. See, you have FDI in insurance sector. If anybody can tell me what technology we have imported, what we have done, these insurance companies have raised funds from here, from us, and exported the profit, repatriated the profits. What interest has they have served to the nation? And see, and I'm a personal witness to this. My students go to the market, they join an insurance company, they work there for a year, say, year or two, they get handsome incentives, and after 2 years, once they exhaust their connectivity and the insuring relatives and other things, they are fired. My God, is this the way nation is being built?
So one important aspect that I got from you, sir, is that we got the slogan right. Somewhere we implemented it wrong. So we couldn't understand, or we didn't understand the actual strength of Indian manufacturing small sector. So we should have followed them. We should have promoted them and benefited them through different incentives and all. But what we did, I think, we tried to understand international standards, and we tried to replicate that through the normal routes of FDI and all.
There is a very very prominent perception. For instance, I'll take just one example. If the value of the rupee is falling, then we would be able to export more. And we compare with China. You see, and there is an international hue and cry that China is containing its currency. It's not allowing the appreciation. Right. Now, and we are trying to compete with China. See, it is very interesting. When the Chinese yuan is contained and the value is, let us say, devalued, what happens? They have a huge lot of exportable surpluses. So they are able to export and beat any economy in the world.
Right.
But when our rupee is devalued, what happens?
We lose.
Tell me. We lose because we don't have exportable surplus.
We import.
So export doesn't increase. On the contrary, the import that we are doing is inelastic.
So we lose actually.
Yes, actually, we end up paying higher.
And this government, they said that we will strengthen our currency against dollar if we come to power, but that didn't happen.
That didn't happen. I mean, we have miserably failed on that front.
So I immediately want to come to the third area, is that startup and Standup India. Because after the manufacturing, if there is any way to retain talent and to promote and employ more talent, it is through entrepreneurship. Now, how do you see startup and Standup campaign? Again, two comments.
When you say startup and scale up, again, it is a fantastic slogan, and but it has yet to take a startup. I feel that perhaps a startup and a scale up is the way out. I strongly feel that this, any whatsoever government comes, they should continue with this program, because foreign capital is not the way. Foreign technology is not the way. Our problem is more of psychology rather than economy. We do have talent. It is very interesting. When an American or British person invents something, he invents. He innovates. When we do something, it is jugaad. So strange. that slave mentality. How when we would be able to shun with this? Anything that we are inventing, innovating, why don't we take it? I mean, the government does have the responsibility of creating perception of the people. Every time we does something great and it is not taken care of. Poverty is a reason. Necessity is the mother of invention. Very often poverty is a blessing in disguise. But when the things are experimented there, they are not being replicated and applied on a larger scale.
So our problem is not the economy, our problem is the psychology.
Yes.
I think we are failing in the psychology game. I have 2-3 messages for the audience, but any last message, how do you see? The people are going to vote in next month, I think the election is starting, the general election. Now, I'm actually, as a journalist, I often get frustrated to see that people do not understand the economic aspect of the country. You know, they do not connect economy when they go to vote. That is very important, because unless they understand the relevance of vote in terms of electing a government which will provide them economic and social solutions, it is not possible to change this nation. Election is coming. What is your message? Considering that these are the problems of the economy and this government has ruled for 5 years and this is where they stand, how should they consider to vote which leader, which party to vote for and elect?
My first message is that any political person, any political party that comes to you, please take their agenda and start asking them questions. This is the first thing and the most primary thing that we can start with, because that will start putting pressure on the people that we have to get back to the masses and respond someday. So that will put a lot of pressure on the governments, whosoever government comes. So start asking for the questions, number one. Number two is that start looking out for a person who has some qualification and credentials. We know each one. Stop voting for the parties. Stop voting for any emotional reason. Be rational. Choose for a good person. I'm sure that your wisdom is one thing. See, just negativism may not help us. We are the part of the system. We have to converge, whether it is government, any government, whether it is Congress, whether it is BJP, whether it is X, Y, Z, any government. Ultimately, it is going to be our government. We have to learn to question the government, number one. Number two, we have to choose for the right people. Then only perhaps something would happen in the nation. Otherwise, I mean, the world is very competitive and it is getting tougher. We have to realize.
So viewers, so each one of us is actually responsible for the lack of development that we are facing today. So what is our responsibility when you go to vote? First, as Professor said, that first ask, take their manifesto, study them and ask them a basic question, that what are they delivering on ground? And do not vote for party or do not vote for ideology, because these are not going to take this nation anyway.
They are not going anyway. To give you bread anyway.
Yeah, they are not going to. Your ideology is not going to give you bread. This emotional attachment to any particular political party is not going to give you any bread to you or to your family or to your generations to come. So what you have to do is study their manifesto and vote for those who can work for you economically and socially. Thank you, Professor,
Thank you.
For this wonderful time. And you keep watching the Policy Times.